Bob, you talk about this tramming and you talk about the soreness. You've got marks to this day, haven't you?
Yes, you see, it was so low that if your back got up like a camel a bit, piece of skin off and all that used to stick to your shirt and pull out.
Mick come on once with every one of his knuckles.
Knocked off.
All, nothing on him, all raw. Every one of his bones from his back. He was on a 2-foot seam or something, he come on and tell me something. And going through, he took all the knuckles off his bones of his back.
What was the attitude to this, though, by sort of the medical officers that you had? I mean, if you had
You didn't go to medical officer with a little bit of skin off your back.
No.
That had to be tested. At home, they used to get iodine bottle out, tap, tap, tap on it. And that wasn't very good as well. But you didn't go in ambulance room with a little bit of a knock like that.
Do you think then they were a bit callous, Joe, towards accidents and...?
The only ambulance facilities you had in those days was... part provided by the old colonists, who must have been the most callous and despicable body of British that's ever been born, actually. And your main assistance in those days was voluntary assistance from the miners themselves. They used to form their own ambulance units, unpaid, and you had your own ambulance team. I myself was a member of the ambulance team, and well, I've been practically in this type of work all my life. And underground, as far as accident was concerned, the people these days would not believe such things could ever happen within the lifetime of persons like us.
Can you give us an example, then, of how callous they were?
Well, I got my first view of this when I was about 9 years old. I was down to the cooperative to get some messages, as we called it in Scotland, groceries and such, from my mother. And I came out of the cooperative, and it would be about 3:30 in the afternoon, and there was about a dozen miners coming down, all in their pit black, pushing a handcart, all round about this handcart. I'd never seen this before, and I stood there and watched it as it passed. And there was a dead miner on the handcart with a brackish cloth over the top of him, and his leg was dangling, black leg was dangling over the end of the handcart. This was them taking a dead miner home. There weren't a coal owner representative there, there was nobody. There was the miners themselves taking one of their own comrades home.
Bob, you worked, you know, for some time in the coal face itself.
Yeah.
Now, we saw in that film the toughness, the conditions and everything. What was it like when you first used a pick, for example, which I saw that man doing it?
Well, you had no training in those days to go into the coal face. You went from tramming straight into the coal, and you'd swing that pick for about, we'll say, 7 hours, and it used to hurt your hands and rub them raw. And I says to my mate, an older man, I said, I can't carry my hands out, so it's terrible, all bleeding. He says, that knows what to do, don't they? I said, well, he said, good piss on them. Well, I did, and believe me, it stung, but it took a lot of the pain out.
Would you believe that, Edna?
Yes, I do believe it, because Mick's done it.
My husband's
done it, yeah. Washed his hands in chamber before he's gone to work, after he's had it. Well, breakfast, I didn't used to have a bit of any breakfast, I'd have perhaps a bit of jam and a cup of tea off the go. Mm. But he always did his hands in pot before he went to work. Mm. And it hardened them, stopped them from blistering. Yeah.
I can remember when we were tramming, the job that Bob was talking about, and of course, your body was so far torn and exerted at this job, so strenuous was the work. You were always soaked with sweat, and of course, as young lads, you naturally broke out in boils. And I had at this time boils right round the back of my neck. And we were tramming this day in this low road, and I happened to come up a bit too quick, and from one of the straps or bars on the top of the holding the roof up, I hit the back of my neck and knocked the top off two big boils. When I got in with the tub to the plate where we turned the tub, the overman was standing there, a fella called Charlie Muir, who incidentally was one of the apostles of the church. He was the head elder of the local church and a very respected figure in the village. And I said to him, Charlie, I says, you got a bandage? He says, yes, son. He says, what do you want it for? I says, I've knocked a couple of heads off of boils, I says, and of course the blood and the pus was running round my neck. And I says, give us a bandage. He says, boils? He says, there's no bandages for boils, he says. And I never got a bandage.